Good. Let's move ahead. Before I move ahead with the things we are going to do today, little bit technical in nature, you will have to put some focus here. I would just give you the brief idea of what we had done last time around. If you can recall something, can just someone tell me that what we had done last time around? You may communicate by unmuting yourself, or you may just put a message in the chat box, whatever the way feasible to you. What we had done last time, any idea about the things? Anyone? Any roundabout answer? Specific topic, if you can recall, we had done last time. थोड़ा थोड़ा याद आ रहा है, समथिंग कॉल्ड पर्सन एज वेल एज द असेसी वी हैड स्टार्टेड विद. एब्सोल्युटली मिस्टर दिव्येश, गुड. सो हु इज पर्सन एंड हु इज द असेसी, दैट वाज द एजेंडा ऑफ द लास्ट मीटिंग एंड वी हैड कंप्लीटेड दैट. नाउ लेट्स मूव अहेड फर्दर. ओके, सो till now we have already seen that what is the direct and indirect tax, the distinction between the two, various parts of the income tax laws which regulates this entire income tax administration in India, and then we had further moved on to the person as well as assessee, and we had concluded last time around that every assessee is a person, but every person cannot be an assessee. The very simple reason behind it is that only the person who is supposed to pay the tax or supposed to pay some penalty or some fees which are imposed by income tax authorities, then only he or she or any other company will be regarded as assessee. Number two, if income tax has initiated some proceedings on the individuals, that means if income tax feels that Mr. Brian is supposed to pay some tax on it, Mr. Brian is of the opinion that no, I am not supposed to pay any tax on it. If there is a dispute, and if income tax has started some investigation, started some proceedings, then also Mr. Brian will be called as an assessee, even though as per his opinion he is not supposed to pay the tax, right? So these are the distinctions we have seen between person and assessee. Today we will discuss about previous year and assessment year, and once this previous year and assessment year definition is cleared, we will be able to understand the residential status in the best effective manner. So what is this previous year and assessment year, first of all? Now, I do not want to go into the technical jargons. It's very simple and easy to understand. For income tax, the year is the financial year. So I hope everyone is aware about the fact that, sir, what is the financial year? Can someone tell me from where the financial year starts and it ends? Anyone? Any idea about the financial year? Yes, Mr. Hussain. Hussain is correct. April to March. Even Ms. Krish is correct. Mr. Divyesh, too good. Sir, it starts with the 1st of April and it ends at the 30th, 31st of March. Now, income tax follows the financial year when it comes to identifying the residential status or, applying some provisions of income tax. So, we are aware that, sir, financial year starts from 1st of April of whatever the year it would be, and it ends with 31st of March of whatever the year it would be. Now, for the income tax purpose, you are supposed to pay the tax of the previous year's income. Please put it in the back of your mind. You may prepare the notes as well for this. So tax on previous year's income. Now, sir, previous year's income माने which income? So whatever the income we have earned in the previous year, on that we'll have to pay the tax. Now, at what time we are supposed to pay the tax? We will pay the tax in assessment year. Okay. Now the next question which might strike in your mind, then, sir, what is this assessment year? Sir, assessment year माने के the current financial year which is going and that is not completed. So which is the year, current financial year which is going and not completed? Can someone tell me the current financial year? Can anyone tell me this? What is the current financial year which is not completed yet? You people know that, sir, financial year completes at March, right? March is not there yet. There are still few months to go in the March. So what is the current financial year? Absolutely correct, Mr. Prince, Mr. Soumya. Very good, Mr. Hussain. Sir, current financial year is 2021. Not completed yet. That's why it is called as the assessment year. In this, the assessment is to be done for your previous year's income. So that means, which becomes my previous year, sir? So my previous year becomes 90-20. So when I say 90-20, that means it starts at 1st of April 19 and it ends to 31st of March 20. So this is my previous year. I am supposed to pay the tax on my previous year of the income of my previous year in which year? In assessment year. Now, one more thing. You are supposed to pay the tax of your previous year's income in the assessment year at a rate applicable in assessment year. Now, there could be some changes in the rates of taxation. Government may come up with some modifications in the tax. So which tax you will take, which rates you will take? Sir, the rate of taxation will be applicable of the assessment year. So that's why we are supposed to first identify that, sir, what is the previous year in the assessment year? Number two, what is the total income of the previous year? And number three, what is the rate applicable in the assessment year? Yes, dear, any question, please? Please? Someone wanted to say something? Someone unmuted his or her mic? Koi na kahin kevu cha beta? Okay, no worries. Kahin vandho nahi. Bhulti thai gyo cha. So let's take few examples. Let's take few examples. So if I say assessment year is 2021, that means my previous year would be 1920, right? Now, please put understand this as well. The previous year, which is 1920, was the assessment year of which previous year? 1819. So for the previous year's assessment, that was the income of 1819. The assessment year was 1920. So obviously the previous year will differ for all the assessment years, right? So I can say that each and every financial year is a assessment year and is also the previous year. Now 2021 is not completed yet. But when the 2021 will get complete, that means on 31st of March of 2021, after the 2 months. After that, this year will become a previous year and the assessment year will be 21-22. So I can say, you can put it in your notes that every financial year is assessment year as well as previous year. So if someone tells you in the question that explain every financial year is assessment year as well as the previous year, you should be able to write at least one page on it. You first need to understand, you need to write that, sir, what is the assessment year? Number two, what is the previous year? Number three, income tax follows the financial year for the income tax calculation purpose. Number four, every financial year is the previous year and every financial year is also the assessment year. So if I give you example again, now this is to be understood in a detailed manner. Why? Because based on this, there are many other things dependent. That's why. So let me take another example again. Say previous year is 2021. This is the previous year. Then the assessment year will become 2022. 21-22, right? Now, if say instead of this, this is the assessment year, then obviously, sir, the previous year becomes 1920, right? So that's the assessment year as well as the previous year. Starts from the 1st of April, ends at the 31st of March. Right now, the current year is not completed. Once the current year is completed, it will become the previous year. Very true. Okay, so that's it. One more thing you must understand from this is, just give me one second. One more thing which you must understand from this is that income tax is to be paid on the income of previous year. So two words you should put in the back of your mind: income of previous year and tax of assessment year. As simple as that. Income of previous year is supposed to be charged at a tax rate applicable of the assessment year. Now on 20th of February, if Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman comes up with some changes and she says that these changes will be applicable in the assessment year 21-22, if those changes will be applicable on assessment year 21-22, that means whatever the income which you have earned during 20 and 21, that will be supposed to be charged at a rate applicable from 1st of April now onwards. So that's it. Assessment year and previous year, you have understood well, right? Any queries till now? Anything you couldn't understand in the assessment and previous year, let me know. Shall I move ahead, please? A short sa confirmation from your side. A small little confirmation that you have understood everything till now, assessment as well as the previous year. Very good, Mr. Krish. Good, Soumya. Good, Priyanka. Good. Good, Ruthvi. Let's move ahead now. Now, sir, why it is important? Sir, it is important to identify what is previous year and assessment year because we want to know that what is the residential status of a person. Now, residential status is dependent on the number of stay of a person in the previous year. Now, see, understand, income tax does not understand the language of citizenship. So, whatever the country's citizen you are, say if you are a citizen of the United States of America, still your income might be chargeable in India. Now that depends on residential status of yours. The scope of income on which the taxation is to be levied is dependent on the residential status of every person. I'm using the word person, not just an individual. So you people are aware that person also includes company, person also includes the Hindu undivided family, person also includes the partnership firm. So that means for every person, the residential status has to be calculated differently. So whether the company is resident of India or not needs to be calculated differently. whether the individual, the normal human being like you and me, is the residential, is the resident of India or not, will be calculated differently. So every person's residential status will be calculated differently. So income tax provisions are dependent on the residential status of India rather than the citizenship. It does not have any relation to the citizenship. You might still be having the green card of United States of America, but you can be a resident of India. And resident of India is dependent on the number of days which you have spent in India. So possible hai ki you might be a citizen of Uganda, but still you are the resident of India because your number of days stay in India was exceeding the number of days given by the income tax. So all the international students staying out here, this must be related to you, even though you might have the citizenship of your respective countries, maybe from Zambia, someone would be coming from some of the parts of Africa, some would be coming from Syria, some would be from Afghanistan. If your stay in India is more than the prescribed limit, then you become the resident of India, even though your citizenship would be of any other country. So once you become the resident of India based on the stay you have here, your income will be calculated differently. I haven't come to the question yet that what extent of income will be charged in India. I haven't come to that question yet because that we'll see when we will see the scope of income. But you must understand the scope of income is dependent on the residential status. So first, our responsibility is to understand what is the residential status. Now, technically, it looks a little bit difficult, but I have made it very simple for you. What I want from your side is just an attention. Tum mujhe khoon do, main tumhe azadi dunga. Tum mujhe attention do, main tumhe knowledge dunga. To beta, thoda sa hame attention ki zarurat hai, aur kuch nahi. Thoda sa focus kijiye. This is going to be the base of various learnings you will be doing in the income tax. Okay, so right now we are looking at the residential status of individual. Residential status of individual. So you people are aware that who is the individual? The person like you and me, male, female, or any other. Might be a minor, might not be a minor, might have got the age of 18, might not have got the age of 18. Every natural human being is an individual. So we are not including the other persons right now. So how to identify whether any individual is the resident of India or not? Now there are three categories in which the residential status of any individual can be identified. Number one is the not resident. Number two is resident and ordinary resident. Ordinary. And number three is resident but not ordinarily resident. Please understand this. There could be three possible bifurcation of individuals' residential status. One is straight away not resident. Another one is resident and ordinarily resident. And third one is resident but not ordinarily resident. So when I say ordinarily and not ordinarily, what do we mean by that? Now this is also dependent on the number of days which you have spent in India. If you have spent so many number of days in last few years, then you will be called as the resident and ordinarily resident. Right? So first responsibility is, so see, now you must have understood, the resident can be either ordinary or it can be not ordinary. So there is no plain simple resident of India when it comes to individual. So our first responsibility is to know that whether the person is resident or not, right? So everyone should start writing it along with me. I'm drawing a chart, and this chart is going to be extremely useful to you. So first thing is you identify whether person is resident or not. Now, to identify whether the person is resident or not, you will have to satisfy one of the two conditions. So first condition is, everyone, you may check it, that the stay in India for the for 180 days or more during the previous year. That means during a previous year, you have understood what is the meaning of previous year, right? During a previous year, if a person was more than or equal to 180 days in India, that is the condition number one. So what is the previous year we have right now? Sir, previous year is 2021. No, sorry. Previous year is 1920. So if you, I want to identify your residential status, then I would go to 1920. So right from the 1st of April of 19 to the 31st of March of 20, I would see that how many number of days you have spent in India. If it is more than 182, you become resident in India for this assessment year. Is it clear? If this condition is not satisfied, then you will have to go to another condition. Now, I am using the word or. You people are aware that why I should use the word or. Because if any of these two conditions are satisfied, then also a person can be called as the resident of India. So it's not and, it's or. Any of these two, not both. You are just supposed to satisfy only one of these two. Then you become resident. Then we will see that whether the person is ordinarily resident or not ordinarily resident. That's going to be the next topic. Okay. Sir, if that person hasn't satisfied the requirement of 182 days in the previous year, then what is the next one we have? Then the next is, we need to check that during the previous year, that fellow has more than or equal to 60 days. And try to understand this. And 360 days or more during the four previous years. 365 days or more during four previous year preceding the relevant previous year. Now, if any of these two conditions is satisfied, you become the resident. So first one is very simple to understand. 182 days in the previous year. Got it. Sir, we couldn't understand the second one properly. I'm coming to that. Now say, if you couldn't satisfy the 182 days in the last previous year, then I need to check that whether that fellow has spent more than or equal to 60 days in India during the previous year or not. So I am using the word previous year. So it's not just previous year. Along with that, you must be there in India for more than or equal to 365 days during the four previous years preceding the relevant previous year. So 4 years before the last previous year. So 4 years before the last previous year, if your total stay was more than 365, along with that, if your last previous year's stay was more than or equal to 60 days, then also you become resident of India. Let's understand this by the help of example. Right now, the assessment year is 2021. So previous year is going to be, say, 1920. 20, right? So before that we would have 18, 19. Before that we would have 17, 18. Before that we would have 16, 17 and 15, 16. Say that particular fellow was in 15, 16, was 100 days in India. Here he was, say, 60 days in India. Here 40 days. Here he was, say, 100 days again. Previous year, say, he was 170 days. Try to understand. Now, first condition is, this particular fellow must be in India for more than 182 days. Now, can someone tell me whether he was for 182 days or more in the previous year? This is my previous year. Whether the first condition is satisfied, yes or no? May I have the answer, please? Through the chat box. Very true, Miss Priyanka. Good, Deepak. Good, Ankit. So first condition is not satisfied. So our first condition to know whether the person is resident or not is straight away not satisfied, because he was just for 170 days during the previous year. Right? Now, if first is not satisfied, then I will go to the second one. Now, second is the combination of two other conditions. Now, second condition is the combination. First part of that second condition is that he or she must be for at least 60 days in the previous year. Previous year, more than or equals to 60 days. Whether this part is satisfied, yes or no? Can someone tell me? Very true. Miss Maya, very true, Jaivik. So that part is completed. But this is not the end. There is a second part of the condition as well. And the second part of that condition is that he must be in India for 365 days or more during the four previous years preceding the relevant previous year. So four previous year preceding the relevant previous year. So that means all the years which are coming before the previous year. So these are the 4 years which are coming before the previous year. So in that 365 days calculation, do not include this previous year. 4 years preceding the previous year. That is the word they have used. So last 4 years preceding the previous year, in that he or she must have more than 365. Do we have more than 365? What is the total coming? It's 300, right? 100 plus 100, 200. And then we have again 100. So it's a 300. So here in this case, his previous year was more than 60 days, understood. But the second part, he is unable to satisfy 365 days condition in the 4 years preceding the previous year. Because his total stay in the 4 years preceding the previous year was just 300 days, which is lesser than 365. That means he couldn't satisfy the second condition. So I can call that this fellow is not resident of India, because he couldn't satisfy any of these two conditions. Number one, 182 days, not satisfied. Number two, 60 days in previous and 365 days or more in the 4 years preceding the previous year. He couldn't satisfy that too. So that means he is straight away non-resident. Is it clear? May I have a confirmation through the chat box? Have you got these two conditions, all of you? Any queries till now? Anywhere you feel that I should explain further? Easy? Good. The crux point lies over here in the second condition. Second condition is not the isolated condition. Second, again, includes the combination of two further conditions. One is previous day 60 days or more. Another is 365 days or more in the four previous year preceding the relevant previous year. When I say preceding, that means years before the relevant previous year. Okay. Okay, let's move ahead. Now say for example, if I make some changes over here in this example only, let's try to understand, huh? Right from 15, 16, we are starting. 15, 16, 16, 17, 17, 18, 18, 19, then 19, 20, and 20, 21. So my assessment year is 2021. This is my previous year, right? Okay. Say in 15, 16, let's take the example of, say, Mr. Steve Smith, who is the Australian cricketer who comes in India to play IPL. Unfortunately, his contract of IPL with Rajasthan Royal is cancelled now. But looking at the caliber and the kind of a talent he has, I think some of the other franchises would be taking him. Anyway, that's not the discussion right now. Let's take the example of Steve Smith. In 15-16, say during the IPL as well as some test series was there in India, and he was here for 200 days. Then in 16-17, he didn't have any test series in India, so his stay was just in the IPL, and that was 60. Then in 17-18, again it was say 100. In 18-19, again there was a test series in India, and he was, say for example, for the entire, you know, year, his total stay in India was 180 days. Right? Now, in 1920, which is a previous year, he was 61 days in India. Now, let's try to identify his residential status. So, we have taken the example of Steve Smith. चीटिंग करने वाला स्टीव स्मिथ जो क्रीज के निशान मिटा देता है बैट्समैन के, कोई बात नहीं. ओके, सो लेट्स मूव अहेड. वेदर द फर्स्ट कंडीशन इज सेटिस्फाइड और नॉट, कैन समवन टेल मी, एनी वन ऑफ यू? व्हाट इज द फर्स्ट कंडीशन? 182 डेज और मोर इन इंडिया, वेदर दैट इज सेटिस्फाइड? No, it's not satisfied. Good. So first condition is not satisfied. What is the first condition? 182 days or more in India. Number two, let's try to identify whether the second condition is satisfied. Second is the combination of two part. Number one, in the previous year, he or she must have more than 60 days or equal to 60 days. So second ka first part, part one is satisfied. Part two, whether the part 2 is satisfied or not. What is the part 2? Sir, 365 days or more during the 4 previous years preceding the relevant previous year. So previous year ko include nahi karna hai. Do not include the previous year. 4 years before the previous years. That means this 4 years. In that, he should have more than 365. So what is the total number of stays we have here? 200, 260, 360. And 360 and 180 again, right? So 460 and 460 and 80. So that would be 540 days. So obviously, sir, 540 days is more than 365 days. So part two of the second condition is also satisfied. That means overall the second condition is satisfied. That means he can be called as resident of India. Now Steve Smith would be like, ओहो, मैं तो ऑस्ट्रेलिया की सिटीजनशिप लेके आया हूँ, लेकिन भैया तुम पूरे साल इधर पड़े रहोगे, आईपीएल में खेलते रहोगे, हमारे बीच रहोगे, इंडिया में टेस्ट सीरीज खेलोगे, तो फिर तुम रेसिडेंट बन जाओगे. दैट मीन्स स्टीव स्मिथ हैज बिकम द रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया इफ वी टेक दिस डिटेल्स. नाउ बेस्ड ऑन दैट हिज टैक्सेशन पॉलिसी एंड द यू नो द इनकम विल बी चार्ज. So if he is earning some of the incomes in India, say IPL contract or any other income, that would be considered to be the income that he has earned from India, and based on the residential status, his income would be chargeable. I'm not coming into the point that what income will be charged and what not, that we'll see later on. But he has become the resident of India as per the Income Tax Act. Very clear? Ekdam aam dimag ma utri gyu. કોઈ જાતનો પ્રોબ્લેમ જ નથી, એકદમ દિમાગમાં ઉતરી ગયું છે, રાઈટ? ઇટ્સ ક્રિસ્ટલ ક્લિયર. ગુડ. Now, once a person becomes a resident of India, then income tax doesn't stop there, because there is again a tax differentiation between ordinary and not ordinary resident. Now, our responsibility is to find whether the person is ordinarily resident or not ordinarily resident. See, first of all, identify. If he is a not resident at all, then the question does not arrive only. To call himself as an ordinary or not ordinary, he must be a resident. So first, one condition out of the two first must be satisfied. Then we are supposed to go into ordinary or not ordinary. So if all these two conditions which we have discussed are not satisfied, he will be called as a non-resident. And if there is a non-resident, then there is absolutely no question of ordinary or not ordinary. If he is a resident, yes, the question arises whether he is ordinary or not ordinary. So the conditions related to ordinary and not ordinary, we will discuss in the next lecture, because that would be quite heavy for you right now if you will be taking this much of a knowledge just in the one session. So till now, we are clear, right? Okay, good. Others, those who are not responding, I'm assuming that you are getting it. In any of the case, if you couldn't, I could see that there was a hand raised by Mr. Nicholas. Yes, Mr. Nicholas, you can ask me the question.
Good morning, sir.
Very good morning.
I was requesting that, if possible, upload for us syllabus and the unit one material. This is going to help us to be following you, and in case of any doubt, it will be easier for us.
Absolutely true. Okay, so I will. The thing is that this shouldn't be said from my side, but there is a possibility that I might be occupied in some of the other things in some days to come. So I think this subject would be handed over to another faculty member. Because of my preoccupancy, right? So that's why I was not doing it. But I don't have any problem in doing that. I would just put it in your Google Classroom is not created yet, but I'll put it in your portal. And from the portal, you will be able to see your syllabus as well as the material we have done till now, right? I'll definitely do that. Okay, Mr. Brian, sir, what is the current tax rate of India? Mr. Brian, this question involves so many other further questions. Number one, who is the assessee? Rate for company is a different, rate for partnership firm is a different, rate for individual is also different. Another question, what is the income? Based on the income as well, the rate could be a different. Another question, what is the type of income? Based on the type of income, the rate of income tax could also be different. So those income tax rates, we will discuss later on, once we will be clear with the assessment year, previous year, residential status, and all the types of assessees and, you know, persons we have seen till now. After that, we'll do it. Is it clear? Because the rate of taxation is dependent on various other things. On type of income too. On capital gains, it's different. On casual income, it's different. And for all other incomes, it's different. For companies, it is different. For partnership, it is different. For local authorities, it is different. So it depends on who is the assessee. Yes, Mr. Jaivik, it has no relationship with the citizenship. Residential status do not have any relationship with the citizenship. You might be a citizen of any country. You might have the dual citizen of any other country. You might not be a citizen of India, that's fine. There is also a possibility that you are a citizen of India, but you are not staying in India. You are staying somewhere else. You are staying, say, for example, in some South African country. Is it clear? So that's the citizenship do not have any relationship when it comes to the residential status. Okay, residential status का identify करने का एक ही तरीका है, number of stay in India, number of days stay in India, as simple as that. Citizenship को बीच में ला हुई मैं. Okay, you can put your attendance over here by enrollment number and your division, and that would be the end from my side as far as this lecture is concerned. Bye bye, take care, sayonara, enjoy the rest of the day. See you all in the next session. Please do not forget to put your attendance.